let's practice, let's make an effort to give up effort, if we can say such a thing. And it's important to say this. Identity cannot be reached, it cannot be realized, it cannot be grasped, it cannot be understood. It can only be abided in. It's abiding in itself. Abidance, the self abiding in the self, is all that there is. There isn't anything else. There is no other identity. There's nothing to grasp that. It's not graspable. It cannot be understood. It cannot be attained. It cannot be reached. All of this. And so we always say, well, what do we do? Relax the effort. I guess you could say relax the effort. How do we relax the effort? By making declarations, I would say. Coming out and saying, hey, you know, I cannot be reached. I'm accepting. I say, I cannot be reached. There's no... When we want to reach what we are, we assume there's something that's reaching that, which would be called an I, or some other identity, some climber that climbs the mountaintop. There is no climber to climb the mountaintop. Non-dual calls it the I. There is no I. It's just a way of talking about the effort to recognize what we are, the effort to reach what we are, the effort to be enlightened about what we are, to understand what we are, to be what we are, etc., etc. But that is all completely futile. That is still the presumption that what we are can be lost to itself. And again, where can nothing and everything hide? How can it be lost to itself? Where can it go to be lost to itself? Where can nothing and everything go? So, it's obvious. I've been watching YouTube. And it's just always obvious that there's still an effort to get it. And it hasn't sunk in yet that it's not gettable. What's going to get it? What is going to get nothing and everything? Simultaneously, nothing and everything. All it is. What needs to get it? Does the body need to get it? Does the personality need to get it? Does the mind need to get it? The spirit need to get it? What needs to get it? And then it's helpful to go back to recognize the basis of trying to get it is the notion that you can also not get it. And that's the real purpose of of existence, is for the self, for spirit to lose itself, to annihilate itself, to die. That's the whole purpose of it. So of course, if there's some attempt to understand what spirit is, there's the duality of that. There's also some non-understanding. Some reaching it, finding it, mean that it was lost or could be lost, etc. So all of that searching, seeking, effort, etc. is unresolved. There's no resolution to it. There's no answer to it. There's not an answer. Abiding in the self is not an answer to anything. It's not a realization. There's no realization. It's an abiding. That's different than a realization. So, as long as we want a realization to take place, we also bring up, we're empowering that there is a non-realization also. As soon as we get the finding, there's a non-finding. So really, it's the flip side. It's still the whole deception of spirit trying to figure out how to die. And all this searching for the self, this search for enlightenment, is really a very clever way of reinforcing death, the notion of spirit dying. Is a stalling, delaying tactic so that spirit can still try to figure out how to die. It's still trying to figure out how to die. This is something that's left out of the non-dual teachings, etc. It's not brought up. But I feel it's very helpful to bring this up. Very, very helpful. Otherwise, we're in this perplexity of, well, why is this effort to seek what we are? Well, why is it there in the first place? And they say, well, don't worry, just drop it. But the reason why we have a hard time dropping it is it's not pointed out that the whole point of trying to discover who we are is really a disguise, a camouflage for trying to forget, to lose who we are, for what we are, to die, to disappear, to go away, to vanish, to be annihilated. That's really what is a camouflage for that effort on our part. That's what Spirit is trying to do. This it doesn't absolutely have to be pointed out, but I would say it's extremely helpful to point this out. Because seeking is a tacit expression of being lost, isn't it? How can it saying that the self can be lost to the self? Everything and nothing can be lost to itself. So it needs to be found. So there is no finding, there is no enlightenment, there's no recognition, there's no realization. There's no discovery. There's nothing like that. There's simply everything and nothing, abiding in everything and nothing, as it always is. There's no realizer. So it's really giving up the demand for there to be a realizer, for there to be a finding. That's then the release from this nightmare. But where does that demand that there be a realizer come from? It comes from Spirit. It doesn't come from ego. It doesn't come from mind. It doesn't come from anywhere else. It comes from Spirit. And Spirit is demanding that it be prime creator. And therefore change what it is, which means to lose what it is. For what it is to be completely lost and gone. So this whole notion of there's some effort to find oneself, we're trying to find ourselves, that is really the expression that the self is lost or can be lost, you see. It's a tricky way of saying it. So there is no realization. So how do we abide, accept the abidance instead of realization? By declarations, by bringing this up, by accepting it, practicing it, saying, hey, there is no realization. I'm not seeking. There is no seeking of realization. I'm dropping the demand for realization. I'm dropping the demand for enlightenment. I'm dropping the demand for all of that. I'm dropping the demand for anything to happen. Because the fact is, nothing has ever happened. Nothing has ever happened to identity. And identity is all that there is. So nothing has ever happened. So don't try to grasp this intellectually, but rather state it. Say, nothing has ever happened. Actually say it. So these videos are really spiritual practice in terms of declaring truth. I feel that the best way is to declare truth. Make a declaration of it. Don't try to figure it out. Because who's trying to grasp it then, you see? Who needs to figure it out? No one needs to figure it out. There's no need to figure out what can never be. There's no need to figure out what never happened. All right. There's a better. There's no way to figure out what never happened. What we're really trying to do is figure out why it never happened. Okay, that's something that's hidden from us. We're trying to figure out why nothing has ever happened. And so we're seeking the self. We're really trying to get an explanation, a recognition of why nothing has ever happened. That is what the self is up to, actually. It's kind of frustrating saying, wow, nothing has ever happened. How come nothing has ever happened? Nothing's ever happened to identity. So this whole path of enlightenment and seeking is a clever disguise of trying to figure out why nothing has ever happened. And to remedy that, actually. And so we want at least enlightenment to happen, you see. We think, oh, if it could just be at least one happening, then that's a starting point. So we say, well, self-realization, if that happens, let's make that a happening. So we're pursuing this one happening, thinking that then, from that standpoint, then we can develop all these other happenings and we can die to what we are. All right, one moment, please. I'll be right back. All right, we're back. So spirit is really trying to generate a happening. It's really trying. That's this whole spiritual path. Everyone is trying to be realized. I notice it. My whole life I've noticed it. I say, what is going on? Something isn't right. There's something that is just doesn't feel right about all of it. All the seeking, the spiritual efforts, and it's really spirit, the self, identity, spirit, trying to come across a happening, something to happen, and a refusal to actually relinquish this demand, that it die. It's a refusal. It's a very intense refusal, actually, because it's saying, no, I am going to have a happening. I'm going to find a happening, and it never does. So they keep on seeking. They keep on trying. The effort is not given up. What a great disguise, right? To dress this all in the garb of seeking for enlightenment. So that is what most seekers, that's what it's all about, actually. That's what most seeking is all about. That's why very few drop the effort. Very few drop the effort. Spiritual pride. The entire situation runs on spiritual pride. All of it. So this is like a breakthrough kind of thing. This stuff, I know, it just pours out. I've never heard of this before. But it rings true. It absolutely rings true. So spirit is determined to have a happening, have a recognition, have enlightenment, have a realization, have a satori, have a samadhi, have a nirvana, have some, it has a happening to spirit. Something actually happened. Not even that happens. None of that happens. Nothing happens at all to identity. There's no place for it to happen. Where can it happen? Where can identity, where can nothing and everything, nowhere and everywhere, have a happening to what it is? What can have a happening to what it is? What can bring about this happening, you see? But spirit thinks that, that enlightenment or something, or a recognition of can happen. Nothing can happen. So here is another declaration. Nothing can happen. Nothing can happen. Nothing can happen. So hopefully we're going towards actually making those declarations. At some point in time, maybe that will begin to kick in. And I see this as better than dialogue. I see dialogue can really just go around in circles. And I see people spend their whole lives, they can spend their whole lives in non-dual dialogue. And again, nothing happens, because nothing can happen. So they have not yet released the demand for something to happen. So it's better to make declarations. It, it puts the whole situation more on the front page, so to speak. Like, nothing can happen. There's nothing that can happen. There's absolutely nothing that can happen. Ever. Nothing can ever happen. Nothing can ever happen. So don't be afraid to make these declarations. It's not like, of course, spirit's afraid that this will be, nothing can happen. So it doesn't want to say, admit to this. It says, no, something can happen. I'm sure spirit says, I'm sure at least something, tiny, 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 tiny something can happen. Not true. Not even the tiniest happening can ever happen. There are no happenings to spirit. There is the totality of experiencing pure awareness and the objects of pure awareness, the experiencing, and that's all one. But there's nothing that ever happens to that oneness. There's never been anything outside of that, so there's never been anything. There's never been a need for any recognition. What does reality need? Does reality need to recognize itself? Does it need some sort of recognition to happen? No, not at all. I wish every day were just like this. 95 in the afternoon in the shaded area. The atmosphere is calm and warm. Love it. So the truth is that in most seekers, I'm looking at most seekers, they're really very much after a tiny happening so that the death of spirit can take place, be recognized. Anything happening is truly a recognition of the death of spirit, actually. That would be a recognition of the death of spirit, so they're very much seeking that. The verbiage and everything else is all spiritual. It's all spiritual. What they're really seeking is spirit seeking its own death. That's what they're still absolutely seeking. They're not interested in relinquishing that search at all. And I'd say the vast majority of those who go to spiritual teachers on the spiritual path, the vast majority are still very much trying to engineer their own demise, the demise of spirit. That's what they're doing. That's what they're all about. Which is fine, because that's what needs help. But they're not really seeking help for that. They're seeking help to actually have something happen, recognize the death of spirit. That's what they're really seeking help for. And that's why they go to teachers and they don't, you know, they're kind of frustrated. They don't get the help that they're seeking. So again, one would ask, well, what do we do? Given this situation, make the declarations, declare, okay, nothing can happen. And even nothing happening is not a happening. That too is not a happening. I give up the demand that anything happen. And even the demand that nothing happening be a happening. This is new territory for me to concretize it like this. Yeah, is it stressful? Yeah, of course it's stressful. Anytime one goes into new territory, I don't care if it's paradise, it seems like stressfulness. You know, there's this like, okay, what's here? You know, wow, I'm not familiar with this place. You know, what other ideas are associated with this? You're waiting for the associates to show up. You see, where are the associates? Where, over there. What else is going to show up? That kind of thing. What else is going to show up? Wow. That's sort of the feeling. What else is going to show up? Maybe nothing else needs to show up. Or maybe something will, I don't know. So when one goes through this burst of acceptance, then there might be a period of a lull. That's fine, just a little bit of a lull. The spirit has been seeking to be prime creator for seemingly, you know, so much in investment in that. That the notion of not giving up that attempt is seems kind of it's like, wow. Spirit thought the attempt to kill itself is spirit. That is spirit's identity, is to transcend its identity. That's how spirit has been taking it. So it almost feels like giving up identity to give up the attempt to transcend identity. So yeah, it is a little bit unsettling. There's some feeling of unsettledness a little bit, but not bad. Not bad. I mean, everything's perfectly functional. You know, there's no sense of non-functionality at all. It's just a kind of a feel like, whoa, what do I do next? What's next? What's next? I'm not really sure what's next. That's the feeling. Not really sure what's next. Whereas most time in our lives, we kind of have an idea of, you know, what we're going to do next. Now, it's interesting that part of my discipline is to never try and expect what's next. I always try to leave the future completely open. I try not to think about what's next at all. I always try to do that. I don't plan. I don't write down stuff down on a calendar. I don't have a schedule. When someone says, like, what are you going to do with the weekend? I say, I got no idea. I have no idea. And that's true. I have no plans. I don't make plans. So, what's the benefit of that? The benefit is I'm able to entertain these whatever you want to call them, these declarations of truth, which are kind of stunning in that from the standpoint of these declarations, you don't really know what's next, and that's okay. It doesn't cause me a problem. Now I can see. If there's someone who's tightly scheduled, and then this is definitely a problem. There's no question about that. So again, what I was told by Jesus in A Course in Miracles and Holy Spirit helping me along is don't plan, don't keep everything entirely open, which I do. I don't know what I'm going to do 5 minutes from now, 10 minutes from now, other than at some point I guess I'll eat something, and at some point I'm going to go to sleep. But even that, when am I going to go to sleep, when am I going to eat, none of that is thought about or planned out. Doesn't have to be any particular time at all. How long will I take? No thoughts about how long it's going to be or how short at all. So I try not to have any expectations of the future. In terms of my functioning, what am I going to do? No expectations. I'm very, very, very used to that. Therefore, these notions that I'm, these declarations that I'm bringing forth here and sharing, don't cause me a problem. The bell gets rung, and I say, whoa, I have no idea what's going to be next. And I say, well, that's okay. That's normal, completely normal for me. I don't know what's going to be next. So, that's the benefit. I'm saying that's the benefit. The Holy Spirit is very wise. He understands this. So, for those who are, everything's scheduled. Well, a lot of people, it's incredible how scheduled they are. I don't have anything on my schedule. Never have. I mean, as far as like vacations or anything and stuff, as far as writing down schedule, what am I going to do literally entire rest of my life? There's nothing scheduled at all. Nothing. I don't have anything scheduled. Not even work. I mean, am I going to work Monday? I don't know. I don't have any expectations whether I will or not. To me, it's just as much possibility that I won't work at all as that I will work. You know, that's how I am. That's how I've been trained. Something else could happen. I don't know. Anything could happen. Anything at all could happen. I don't know. But nothing has happened really in my life. It's not like when you say, well, anything at all could happen, that doesn't mean something wild or something different that's kind of going to happen. No, it doesn't mean that. But what the benefit of this is that these declarations that nothing has ever happened and nothing ever will happen to identity doesn't cause me any problems. Doesn't throw me into a panic. So I'm able to look at this, look at it, and it's all okay. Whereas someone who's tightly scheduled, they will immediately say, whoa, wait a minute, I've got all this stuff, it has to happen in the future, I gotta shut this down right now. Not allowing the situation to present itself as it is. And so I'm just sharing with this, nothing's happening as far as different or anything else. Everything, the sky is still here, the ground is still here, the surroundings are still here. Everything is still here, the body's still here, still talking, still taping, the video camera's still working, everything. So, it's important to let this sink in. And if you are tightly scheduled, you probably would feel extremely threatened by this. So I'm one of those who's able to make use of not doing anything. Someone says, nothing, get up, nothing to do, nothing, I have nothing in mind to do anything at all. And then I end up in inquiry, which then is able to deepen to the point where I see nothing ever has ever happened, and nothing will ever happen. But that's okay. There's nothing that needs to happen in the world, and nothing that also needs to not happen. because in terms of identity, nothing can happen. You might, well, nothing can happen and everything can happen. Simultaneously, both, as it were. It's beyond duality. It is beyond duality. Duality cannot grasp it. It's a unity. And so, again, if you're scheduled, you can say, well, how do I translate this into my schedule? How do I translate this into what I'm going to do next? And for me, I don't go there. I'm not trying to apply it to any happening in the world. I'm not trying to apply this insight to anything. So that enables it to deepen. It enables it to set, as it were. I'm not thinking about how do I apply this to some situation at all. The thought doesn't even arise. Or if it does, it seems very unnatural to even consider that. Because there isn't any situation. There aren't any situations. That's the purpose of it, is to finally accept there aren't any situations. There isn't anything happening. If there's nothing happening, how can there be any situations? Now, I used to try and avoid all situations, hoping that that would be good enough, but no, that's not realization. That's still trying to appease the world. You know, I tried to appease the world because the world seemed, the demand was so ferocious here. I said, well, wow, gotta try to at least kowtow to that. It's just too overwhelming. But it's not that you avoid situations, that you realize there are no situations. There's never been any situation. No situations ever arise. Only identity is. So all this, all situations, everything that we think is happening, all situations that we think are happening, believe are going to happen, etc. It's all spirit trying to die. That's all it is, which is completely futile, meaningless. So therefore nothing is happening. Spirit cannot die, so nothing is really happening at all. There are no situations at all. And there's a sense that of some kind of relief there. I just got a sense that there's some, it's still dim, but there's a feeling like that could be, bring a lot of relief with it. It could be like a breeze, a warm breeze blowing away the cold, clammy atmosphere. Change of atmosphere, as it were. So everything that I played along with as if it were a situation, I realize it never was a situation. It never was. Nothing's ever happened. That's why we don't have a life. There's never been a life. Nothing's ever happened. Our whole life is both a series of happenings. No, there's never been any happenings. Therefore, we've never really been born at all. We were never born. We never die. There's no happenings at all. Nothing is happening to us. Nothing has ever happened to us. So that when I talk about ironing out the wrinkles, you can feel how making these declarations is moving us towards ironing out these wrinkles. The wrinkles of believing that something has happened. In identity, there are no wrinkles. So all these wrinkles that we iron them out, we release them and say, none of that has anything to do with what I am. It never has, never will. That's actually an attempt to die to what I am. A futile attempt. So when you hear talk about someone releasing all their past lives and all the memories erasing, all the stuff, ironing out the wrinkles, it's a release of the demand that something happened to identity. It's realization that none of that has been a happening at all. All that was going on was a projection of a demand that something happened. But nothing actually did happen. It's just the play of demand. You might say that existence is just a play of demand. It's just this demand that there be a play. It's not even a play, it's just this demand that there be a play. And the insistence that there is, even though there isn't. So it's kind of realization that nothing has never been any play at all. It's only been our demand that there be one. It's only always been identity, abiding in identity. It's kind of like climbing Mount Everest, isn't it, right now? I mean, you take a couple steps and you go, wow. Do I go any further? Do I dare go any further? You know, that's what I feel like. Wow, do I dare go any further? It's like everything is just gonna poof, you know, just like vanish. The belief that something ever happened just vanished, and you realize nothing's ever happened. Oh, wow. So it seems like you jump into the abyss of nothing has ever happened to identity, other than identity, abiding in identity, in which nothing and everything is continuously present. But not as a happening, but merely as a presence, a continual presence. Presence is continual. It's seamless. Presence is seamless. Whereas happening, the demand for happening is a demand that this seamless presence die. So the effect of this declaration is simply sort of a bit of uneasiness. Of like, what's next? What's next? Is there be some disappearance of a collapse of what was never there? Realization, recognition that the world, to disguise its purpose, it may cause an external collapse, as if to say, all the stuff, these happenings, they've all collapsed, but that still is an attempt by spirit to annihilate itself. It's not that there's been happenings and we need to erase those happenings. It's what we need to realize: there's never been any happenings, so there's nothing to erase. You might say there's never been any wrinkles, therefore there's no wrinkles to iron out. But what we are ironing out is the belief that there are wrinkles to iron out. There's never been any problems. So what we're ironing is something out. The difficulty always comes because the so-called imaginary play, the non-play, but the belief there's a play happening, it always seems to be intensifying. And during the last 50 some odd years in this world, it's just been exponential, unbelievably exponential. So it's very, seems difficult to conclude that nothing is happening, because it seems as though the amount of change is easily defined as something happening. It's kind of like rearranging nothing, symbols. So it's almost like it's like existence always seems to be on top of us. And we're being dragged in it, you know, we're in its dust. And so this acceptance seems to be difficult. And we yearn for the good old days. They go, if only I went back in time and what I know now, I went back in time. And then, it'd be easy to realize. It'd be easy to accept this. But right now, good grief, you know, it's so difficult to accept it. So this is a time when it the appearance of difficulty is very strong. But it really has always been that way. It's just that it keeps pace, no matter what our efforts are. It seems like the world keeps pace. So it always seems as though there's so many wrinkles to be ironed out. So many problems to be solved. So many happenings to be non-recognized. And so it always keeps pace like this way. It's like a shadow. No matter how fast we run, the shadow's still there. We think, wow, I can't shake that shadow. What is that shadow? It's the desire for spirit to be prime creator is the shadow. So we can't outrun your shadow. You have to stop generating a shadow, as it were, or don't try to outrun anything. Don't try to go faster than anything. At the same time, recognize that you're under tremendous pressure to outrun it. So you better get into acceptance that reality doesn't have any shadow. That the shadow is only your demand that you die to what you are. That's what it is. And you can give up that demand by choosing the idea of not trying to transcend what you are, not trying to change what you are, not trying to be prime creator. And that acceptance doesn't produce a shadow, doesn't produce a desire, a demand to transcend what you are. So in other words, if you have a desire to transcend what you are, no matter how fast you run, that desire is still with you. You can't outrun it. So let's not be in a hurry here. Let's not be in a hurry to outrun something. We're not trying to outrun the world. At the same time, we realize there is this black hole sucking us in. as long as we think we are, as long as we need to have a happening take place, then we will feel like we're being sucked into this black hole at this time. We'll be struggling, you know. Oh, I don't want to go into this black hole. But the recognition that nothing can ever happen, where's the black hole? Poof. Never was a black hole. So the way to overcome is to realize there is nothing to overcome. No need for any overcoming at all. Again, is this understood? No, it's not understood. Is it accepted? Is the question. Spirit doesn't need to understand anything. It needs to accept that it cannot change what it is. And Spirit says, well, what about this? What about this? Or what about later in time? What about the future? What about, it cannot change what it is ever. No way, it's impossible. Just like spirit cannot disappear from itself. Where can it go? And Spirit uses this notion of time, invents this notion of time, and then tries to make this time as something growing towards spirit, going towards salvation, as it were. But that just then brings time into play, which really spirit is using it to claim that it has time to lose what it is, to die to what it is. Because without any time, how can it die to what it is? It already is what it is. But so by claiming a usage for time that is benevolent, some benevolent usage for time, it's clinging to time. Where then the non-benevolent use of time seems to be possible, you see? So again, Spirit always claims that if you give up time, you'll give up all the good stuff of time, all the good potential of time. That's a trick. That's its trick. That's the trick of mind. There isn't any truly benevolent usage of time without the fact that there's a non-benevolent use of time, as it were. At least the time is the desire, expression of the desire for spirit to die. Absolutely it is. You might say the only right usage of time is to realize there is no right usage of time. It's 100% the desire for spirit to die, learn how to die, time, 100%. Spirit says, I need time to die. I can't die now because I'm abiding. There's nowhere to die. Where can I go? So it says, I need time to learn how to do this. I need a place. I need space. I need time. I need a place to go die. I need time to learn how to die. So of course time is spirit trying to learn how to die to what it is. Right now. Right now. It's always is what it is right now. How can it be dead to what it is right now. It's impossible. So Spirit says, time. Well, and then it says, oh, no, I'm just using time to be enlightened. I'm just using time to for benevolent, to become what I am or to realize what I am. No, it's not. Because there's still time. And Spirit says, oh, there's time. That means I can learn to be something different than what I am. There's a space, time and a space. There's a way. There's time where nothing is completely what it is. There's a process, not like process. There's a process going on. Let's find out what the outcome of this process is. But there really is no process taking place, none. Time is not really a process. It's a demand that there be a process. But the demand that there be a process doesn't mean there is a process. So all that Spirit is really experiencing is its own demand that it not be experiencing. But it's not actually a not experiencing. It's a demand for not experiencing. So it's like Spirit's holding its breath and saying, all this stuff I have not been experiencing. There's been no experiencing all this time. And then when Spirit finally lets out its breath, it realizes it's always been experiencing. It's always been what it is. So your entire life is actually, you've actually been experiencing everything. Even though there's been a demand that you not be experiencing anything. That you not be experiencing it. That the experience is always in the future. It's always time-based. But actually, you have been experiencing your entire life. Which is when you realize that, you realize your whole life's been a total failure. Because the purpose of your life has been to not experience your life. And then the realization, oh my God, I've been experiencing my entire life. He's like, oh my. He said, for Spirit, I guess worse than death, all my stuff, worst thing. Oh my gosh, I've been experiencing my whole life. My whole life has been experienced. Oh my gosh, that's terrible. I've had a few instances where I realized that. It's like I jump back and say, oh my gosh, I actually am experiencing everything. Like, how's that possible? Oh my gosh. So. Truth is, everything is being experienced. Always has been. Always will be. There's only experiencing taking place. Experiencing within pure awareness is always the case. But we are insisting, though, there's this thing called a life, which is, in time, is not experiencing. It's trying to get to experiencing. We're trying to get to it. We're trying to reach experiencing. There's something that's trying to reach experiencing. All the while, this experiencing is always taking place. Even right now, there's only experiencing taking place right now. Even though it doesn't feel like it does. It doesn't feel like it because what we're projecting is a demand. We're not really, when we're projecting this demand, that as it were makes us unaware that we're experiencing. So Spirit does have this capability to be unaware that it's experiencing. But that's all it can do. It cannot change the fact that it is experiencing, but it can be unaware of it. By demanding that it not be experiencing. Demanding a loss of experiencing. Demanding a loss of itself, of identity, which is experiencing in pure awareness. So by projecting that demand, there is this sense of that we're not, there's a lack of awareness that experiencing is taking place, but it still is. So we do have, spirit does have, its creativity does have this extraordinary capability of being unaware of experiencing is taking place. But again, that doesn't mean that it's not taking place. It is. It is. It's like we can close our eyes and we say we don't see anything. And we can open them. Was all the stuff here? My eyes were closed? Yes, it was. It was still all there, but we can shut our eyes. It's like a demand that it not be there. It's still there. So there have been a few times in my life where I suddenly became aware of the richness of experiencing this just incredible, complete richness. And then I was aware that I've always been experiencing that. And yet I shut down the awareness of this. But I realized it's still going on. It's like, wow. You know, what is that? It's amazing, huh? And there's no experiencer other than the experiencing. The experiencing is the experiencer. The experience and the experiencer are one, nothing and everything. You might think the experience is the experiencer. There's no need for an experiencer. The experiencing is complete in itself. That's another way to put it. But however you want to put it in words, it's still taking place. We're just not aware of it. And this unawareness is a continual thing. It's a continual projection of our demand that we be unaware of this. As an attempt to die to what we are. This attempt to die to what we are, the price we pay is we're simply unaware that we are what we are. That's the price we pay. That is the price we're paying. So it's a feeling of like shallowness. Like I say, like being a fly being stuck on flypaper. Stuck, feeling a stuckness, a shallowness, unfulfilledness, uneasiness, a lack of something. That's the price we pay. And yet, all the riches the experiencing, the richness of experiencing is continually there. It's still taking place. Amazing, huh? So has spirit missed out on this experiencing, is the question. I don't know the answer to that right off the top of my head. Can we get that back? Can we missed out on this experiencing? So does experience need to recapitulate that, etc.? And so there's a little hesitation here. Thinking, oh my gosh, I've not been aware that I've been experiencing everything. So how do I go back? Do I need to go back to my childhood and re-experience all that? Or how do I get all this experiencing I've been unaware of? How do I make up for all that or something, you know? I don't know. That's a good question. Maybe the answer can come. That, you know, we give space to that answer to arrive. It's a very good question. Perhaps the answer is there is no experiencer. That experience itself is the experiencer. And that the richness of each moment is perfect, is complete. So there's no sense of missing out on anything. And that anything can be re-experienced, anything and everything, it doesn't matter. There's something there that has to be realized. It's important to see that we can approach this. And I say by realized, I mean resolved. As far as some little hesitation is there. It's like we don't want to accept that we've been missing all of experiencing. We've lived the, what we call life is just a denial of experiencing. I guess at first time we will realize that we don't need any more lives. We don't need to deny that experiencing is taking place anymore. Therefore, we don't need to be born anymore. So freedom from any more births is certainly there. Realization that we were never born, we never had any births actually. So we'll see what happens with this. When you come up upon a stumbling block like this, you can simply abide there and simply say, okay, there's a stumbling block, and just don't need to attack it, don't need to do anything, just stay calm, catch your breath, and just trust that this will resolve in some way. Don't know how it's going to resolve, but in some way it will. Don't expect a certain resolution to it. The resolution has to be this or that. Don't expect it has to be this or that. Say, I don't know. Whatever it is fine. One way to look at it is that the self experiencing didn't miss experiencing. So who needs to have it made up? The demand that there not be experiencing, but that's gone, that's dropped. So what is it that needs to have it made up? What is it that needs to make to go back and experience it? If experiencing has always been experiencing it, and there really isn't a need. Where's the need to? What is it that needs to experience it? And the demand is simply that there be a future. Is the demand. In other words, there be time. The demand for time is really the demand that there be a future. From right this instant, right now, how we're expressing our demand to die to what we are is that there be time, which means that there be a future of non-experiencing, as it were. And so that is what we're really experiencing is we're experiencing everything, but we're demanding that there be a future that we're not. And so that's where our attention is somehow. So in giving this up, it's like they were giving up the demand that there be this future. And then that allows the awareness of what we're of our experiencing right now to be there without this projection of a demand that there be a future. We can go over these things. It doesn't mean that it's going to instantly resolve. Old habits die hard like that, but it means we can get to this point and look at it. Now we might say, oh, it's so difficult to get to this point. We better resolve it right now. I'll never get back to here. So let that dissipate. It's so difficult, we can never get back here. Don't try to do anything about that, just let that dissipate. Oh, it's so extraordinary, it's so rare, you can never get back here. And by practicing that, we can then, I would say, we probably get to the point where we can actually experience, be aware of that we're experiencing, without thinking that's some kind of rare, extraordinary accomplishment. We can never get back here, and without trying to grab a hold of it or symbolize it somehow. What happens is we have this glimpse that we are experiencing right now, and we think, oh my gosh, this might be the only time I'm ever going to feel this, and I need to try and capture the moment, get a snapshot, and let it inspire me to do all this art, you know, anything. I just need to be inspired by it instead of saying, oh, wait a minute. Maybe I can just abide in this. Let's not throw in the towel and say, this is it. I have my glimpse of nirvana, and now let me work on all these malas, you know, and beautiful artwork and stuff to inspire others to have this glimpse too. No. That's not the goal at all. It's like saying it's rare to have a glimpse of timelessness within time. Well, it's impossible. What happens is we for a moment we drop our demands for a future, for time. So when we do that, it's inevitable we experience. It's inevitable. We're aware that we're experiencing right now. So you can't say it's rare at all. Now you can say, well, is it rare to drop the demand for time? Not if we're approaching it from the context that we're approaching it right now. Because it's not a question of rarity or not. It's a question of acceptance or demand. We see it's a projection of a demand. We're aware of our demands that there be time, that we believe in time, that there be a future. And so awareness of this context means we can approach it easily. We can approach this easily. It's not some lucky draw. That luck's got nothing to do with it. Now we might be unwilling to do it, and we might schedule a bunch of stuff and get caught up in the world. That's possible, it happens all the time. So there is that, for sure. But if we dissolve this feeling of difficulty, the mysticism, luck, all this stuff, let it just dissolve and say, hey, we're right here. Outside the gate, says it, we're just right here outside the gate, let's just hang out here. Outside the gate, says it's easy to be here. Let's not rush, try to rush. I gotta grab it right now because it's the only chance I'll ever have. No, let's just be relax. See, how do we get here? How do we get to the gates here? And go over that. Remind ourselves, how do we get to the gates here? And say, oh yeah, we've walked along that path quite a few times. We can do that. There's no mystery to it, no luck to it. We just realize that spirit is trying to be prime creator. It's therefore demanding that it die to what it is so that it can be resurrected as a new spirit, self-created, that this resurrection comes from itself, that it has some power, some power greater than God. And so there's this demand that Spirit's trying to learn how to die to itself. Therefore, it needs this idea of time to learn this. It can't be aware that it's experiencing right now, because it would be aware of what it is, and that there's no possibility that it can be anything other than what it is. So it has a demand that there be this imaginary condition called time, and it has to believe that in this future it's not experiencing. So we're really just imagining a future in which we're not experiencing. We're doing this right now. But we really are experiencing right now. We really are. So we're projecting this demand. That's all. Spirit's projecting this demand. So it is easy to get to this point. Now we may have to get to this point many times. Keep getting here, keep getting here. And keep trying to drop the demand for time. The demands of time. Which necessarily implies process. No process, how can you say there's time? Everything is complete. Each and every moment, how can you say there's time? Where's there a need for time? And what process could there possibly be except Spirit wanting to learn how to die to what it is? To change what it is. It's the only reason there could ever arise this demand for a process, for time. And this process has to be in the future, because we're actually experiencing right now everything. Totality. Totality is experiencing itself right now. The totality of all that is experiencing the totality of all there is right now. And it's our demand that this not be the case, that this be changed, is a projection of what's called a future of time, that the next moment it's not going to be this way. We're going to enter into this time, this very next moment. We never enter into it. No one's ever entered into time, actually. There's never been an entrance. But there is an expectation, a demand, that the next moment we will enter into it. And these demands and expectations can increase in intensity. So we have this world right now. There's an enormous intensity of expectation that we're going to enter into time. Enormous. So that's why it's difficult in the world right now. The demands are very, very intense. Is anyone in time now? No. And no one, there never will be an entrance into time. But there can be a demand and a buildup of expectation and demand that it's imminent. It's imminent. We're almost entered into time. The world thinks that it's on the verge of entering into time. The world calls this the golden age. The world thinks it's on the verge of entering into time. So, that's what holds us back. We think, oh my gosh, what's going to happen when I enter into time? I better get ready for it. I need to be realized, enlightened, or something. When I enter into time, wow, that's going to be a whole different thing. I won't be experiencing. I better be enlightened when I enter into time, so that I can have the sense of experiencing once I enter into time. No, but no one ever, there is no entering into time. There is no entrance into time. Never happens. It never happens. It will never happen. So we don't need to be enlightened. See, we don't need to be enlightened. How's that for good news? We don't need to be self-realized, because we'll never enter into time. So we don't need to have, carrying some precious package into time with us like a baby. We want to have that baby with us as we enter into time, so we can not be entirely annihilated. there will never be an entrance into time. Say, I will never enter into time. No one will ever enter into time. There is no entrance into time. Ever. Ever. So the totality of all that is right now experiencing the totality of all that is. And we're preparing to enter into time. So, oh my gosh, maybe this next tomorrow I'll enter into time. So I better have somehow kind of conceptualize the totality of all that is, experiencing the totality of all that is. Oh, I need to be enlightened. I need to carry this realization of this into time with me. See, it'll never happen, so we don't need that realization. We don't need a realization. We don't need an enlightenment. We don't need anything. We already are. The totality of all that is already is experiencing what it is. So, there you go. This is the resolution, the answer we're looking for. It's different than expected. I had no clue about this before. I didn't know the answer. This is redefines everything, just complete redefinition. Like, wow. It's we think we're going to be deprived. We've never actually been deprived of experiencing. We think we're going to be. So we're trying to figure out, how do I carry all that experiencing with me into time? And the answer is, we don't need to, because we'll never step into time. We're just expecting to. It's that expectation that drives us all crazy. The reason why everything's all nuts is we're all frantically preparing to step into time. That's why. Ah, man, that's something. And the reason why we can't get through to people is they say, oh my, what are you talking about? You know, I can't stop my efforts. I'm almost about ready to step into time, and I've got to pack my bags and have everything ready, my mementos. I got to be able to remember everything. I got to bring it all with me into time. So, of course, they're not going to, you know, ease up on those efforts. The more they believe they're going to enter into time, the more frantic the efforts, the more they'll block out anyone that says, hey, take it easy. What are you preparing for? No need to prepare. I say, oh my God, you're trying to impoverish me. What a horrible thing to do. So that is the problem in this world. Who is it that is not making no efforts to prepare to enter into time? Who is it that will accept this, you see, accept, wow. So again, we forged in new territory, entirely new territory. For me, me too, absolutely. Never saw this before. So it literally completely changes the whole playing field. You know, it's just like, I don't know what to think next. What to say next. What to, I don't know. That's okay. No problem. At some point, I'll get hungry enough. Well, I'll go eat. That's it. That's fine. Okay. But it's important to get a new territory. Don't try and figure out what you're going to do next. Just spend some time relaxing. Okay. Wow. This is a monumental step, you know, we've taken to get into this territory here. Milestone type of thing. Completely new way of defining what's taking place, actually. Completely new way of defining it. A redefinition of what's going on. What is everyone doing? What's going on in the world? Everyone is frantically preparing to step into time and trying to figure out how can they bring with them the richness that they feel that they'll be losing in time? How can they stay in touch with what is timeless? How can they do this, expecting at any moment that they will step into time? So of course everybody's nuts, you know, it's just like, everybody's freaked out. Everybody's trying to figure it out, figure that out. And the answer is, it doesn't need to be figured out, because no one, there will never be any stepping into time. That is the answer. So we can relax our efforts. We can say, wow, imagine that. I can literally now just enjoy experiencing without any kind of worries or concerns. And if I say I mean the acceptance of all that is, experiencing all that is, can simply abide in that, accept the abidance of that. The notion is that in stepping into time, we will then be a self, some sort of self. So we're working on that. So I'm like, how does all that is cease to be all that is and be fragments, you see? Stepping into time, of course, would be a complete fragmentation of eternity, is the notion of eternity no longer being eternity. And so it's a fragmentation. We're thinking, oh, we'll be all these individual selves. And so how do I get this individual self to be experiencing all that is once we step into time? So we're all trying to figure this out, trying to figure it out. And the answer is, it will never happen. So we don't need to figure it out. So this is this is like sacred territory, very profound territory. What do you do? What do you do? I mean, sit a while. Relax a little bit. Mind is kind of like, wow. It's kind of going like this, but it's reverberating. But I'm just, you know, I say, oh, it's okay, no problem. I know that this is not a problem. Having been forged into new territory so many times, I just say, okay, I know, you know, it's not a problem. But this is like incredibly profound. I know that most people won't see this. No matter how profound it is, it won't register. So I have to prepare for that, but I have to prepare for sharing it too. But I'm not doing that at this point. Just say, well, you know, whatever happens, happens. But if it's shared, that's fine. If it helps, fine. But no expectations one way or the other. And it could be it, you know, it could be like everyone just clicks and says, oh my gosh, this is completely true, and it just becomes an amazing situation in the world. That could happen too. That's possible. I don't know what's going to happen. But this is, you know, extremely profound. I'm aware of that. I'm aware this is extremely profound, no question about it. So, it could be something truly monumental. I don't know. I'm not really planning for one thing or the other. I want to keep my mind just open without any narrative to it, really. Just let it be. Let it be. Let it be. That's words of wisdom. Just let it be. Let it be. Just sit with it and let it be. No projection of how it's going to be. Just let it be. again, the gist of it is the realization, the recognition that time has never happened. What we've been doing is we've been preparing to step into time, but no, it's never happened. There's never been any stepping into time ever happen. We've been preparing to do it. And there's been expectation that it will happen at some point. But that point is never arrived at, it will never happen. So we don't need to prepare for this happening. We don't need to prepare for this happening. And yet everyone is wrapped up in their preparations for this, which is why they seem to be unavailable for clarity. When they go to a teacher, they think the teacher's going to help them prepare for this. You see, that's why they go. They expect the teacher to help them prepare to step into time. The teacher tells them, no, you'll never step into time. Don't worry about it. So, and the quality of reassurance that the teacher has is what helps, is a quality of certitude of reassurance that really helps. And that's rare. It's rare to come across in this world one that is a situation where there is this total reassurance and certitude. That is rare. But now we say, why not? You know, why not? Absolutely. That can absolutely be present. Why not? So this is a big one. It's like hooking a whale, you know. It's like throwing a net out and you pull in and you're looking for little fish and there's a whale in the net. So you say, oh, what do I do with the whale? Wasn't expecting a whale, but kind of we were expecting something great. I've been telling, saying, expect something tremendous to come. Now we're in June. See, May was the watershed month, May 2013. And now here we are in June 1st. And what happens is this monumental clarification. And I said, June 30th, expect some relief. June 30th, expect some relief. So I'm aiming for that. So I'm expecting some monumental recognitions and clarifications. Absolutely, of course. This is the time for it. This is the time, and they've been happening. Along with the resistance. In May, I had many dreams, very wicked dreams, attempts. I realized these are things to try and, you know, stop this. And I, you know, got now this mental clarification here. It's just like, wow, this is a game changer. So I realize it's a game changer, and this is reverberating now, just reverberating. But I'm not trying to project into how it's going to play out or anything. No, try to stay away from that. I'll probably go in. I've got something to eat and watch the Giants game. Or check out the upload that is taking place right now on YouTube. I usually have an upload taking place as I'm taping this. Maybe it already did upload. There's another video prior to this one that I'll probably upload first, so you'll be seeing that before you're actually seeing this one. I've been taping all day today on a Saturday. So I'll probably, you know, get that upload going, get these uploads going, so they're in the pipeline, so they can get out to the world. And you might be seeing this on, you know, June 2nd, or June 3rd, or something like that. Possible. At which point, who knows what will be taking place. I don't know. this has the feeling of a game changer more than, you know, well, I don't want to put expectations on it, but it feels very much root, because any effort to then take this game-changing realization or clarification, prepare to take it into time, I would immediately say, wait, no. There is no reason to prepare for that. So it's kind of like a dissolver. It's a great, like, solvent. Great dissolver. It's deeper than the other clarifications. It's more of a dissolver of all troubles. It may keep reverberating as possible. It might keep reverberating. It's like a bell that keeps ringing. That's possible. It still certainly is, or still ringing right now. It's just kind of my nervous system. It's just, you know, it's like, this whole feeling of just like, wow. Don't know what to expect next. And one thing we can expect next is that we won't be stepping into time next. One thing is certain, we won't be stepping into time. So what do we need to pack? Why do we need to pack our bags? Why do we need to judge what to take with us and what to leave behind? We don't need to judge that. What do we take and what do we leave behind? We can, once again, accept the totality of awareness of experiencing without trying to pick and choose of what are we going to take with us in time to remind us of, you know, everything. What symbolizes everything? Do we need to take pictures of Ananda Mayama with us? I pack my bags. I have all her pictures, you know, so I can take them with me when I step into time. But when we realize we never will step into time, what do we need to have a suitcase full of stuff? So this is a game changer here, game changer. You might find that you're tired. You feel tired, like, oh, then you can go take a rest. You know, just, wow. Which I can certainly do. So the whole idea of really being on the path is to experience these game-changing redefinitions. Shift of perspective. That's the whole point of it all. So of course you will do so. So this is fine, this is good, this is great, it's exactly what I really want. But I really don't know what's next, which is okay too. What's for dinner? I don't know. Maybe grab some peanut butter. No, all right. So this is great, really great, really great. June 1st has turned out to be an incredible day. Monumental day. It's like almost like the end of days, knowing that there aren't any days at all, actually. There's just a seamless experiencing of all that is. So here come the skateboarders. He's like, oh, dang, that dude in the video. All right, very great.